communities as a whole think and feel about civic engagement. So some of you guys saw lots of flowery language, right? An urban think tank on civic engagement, a collective conversation about Black capital and social influence. What we're really talking about is, tell me what it is that you value and what you're willing to risk to get it. We all know that the media loves to talk about us, right? They love to talk to us, at us. I don't see many talks with us, and I don't see many people letting us speak for ourselves.
I think the strength is our melanin, the fact that we are directly connected to Africa, that we are the closest thing, in my opinion, to God on this earth. But then I also think that that is the biggest threat, the fact that we are the darkest, and the fact that we can't blend in. That is the reason why so many of us try to do everything that we can to step away from that, because everybody else on this earth know that we are God's and goddesses, but we, but us.
I feel like our community is very quick to know when something doesn't feel right, when it doesn't look right, when it doesn't feel authentic. And one of the really good things is that you get called out on that a lot. You know, that's why a lot of things that try to infiltrate, you know, when you see people trying to, you know, be culture vultures, we instantly call it out. No, that's not box braids. No, that's, you know, this isn't, no, he didn't create
big things. Mark Jacobs did not invent dancer knots, y'all. He did not invent dancer knots.
So I feel like we have that really innate ability to pinpoint when something isn't right.
I think the sad thing about it is that I think the biggest threat to Black people is our own psychology.
I think the weakness sometimes is you're not always sure what to do about it.
I think one of the problems in our community is we won't admit one horrible truth, and that's most Black people don't like being Black. And I can see that in the way that we act, in the way that we talk, in the way that we engage with each other. And it's sort of hard for us to engage politically, socially, mentally, as it pertains to our people moving forward when we don't even like ourselves. So we can tell people to buy Black, but if you don't like being Black, then it's impossible to do that.
He says, I don't know how to talk to you. I don't know how to ask you if you're okay. And that's the first lyric. And later on, he says, maybe I'm just too good to you. And I think about Black people in that way when we look at America. I think Black America's message to America is, maybe I'm just too good to you. Maybe the way that I engage you, maybe the way that I have been pacified, or maybe the way that I'm trying to use my voice to kind of calm down and be okay and be nice and be that. Like, I get it. Like, I'm a light-skinned, marginally handsome on a good day. Like, a likable Black guy who smiles, right? So white people are a lot more comfortable with me sometimes. But that pacification that you're talking about sometimes doesn't really do us a whole lot of good.
See, I give people the example. They said rap music is not selling, R&B is dead. But Justin Timberlake doesn't have a problem selling R&B. Adele doesn't have a problem selling R&B. Eminem doesn't have a problem selling rap. Macklemore doesn't have a problem selling rap. The problem isn't the music. We don't see worth in the people who look like us anymore. So until we engage and talk about the mental aspects, even me, I've been conscious. It's funny, people think I got conscious yesterday. I've been conscious since the 11th grade. I was just high and drunk and broke. It ain't easy being conscious when you're hungry. But what I tell people is this. I've been conscious since the 11th grade, but it literally took almost 10 to 12 years to get the white picture of Jesus out of my head. You know? And so I tell people all the time, it's easy. They talk about little Black kids killing each other. Well, if you don't think Jesus looked like you, Superman, Spider-Man, Wonder Woman, Batman, every God complex in America is white. And Black people are more spiritual than the two contemporary religions that most Black people believe in. Black Muslims are more spiritual than any Arab I've ever met. Black Christians are way more spiritual than any white Christian I ever met. People always telling me about Jesus and God, but I don't see Jesus and God in your actions. I don't see that in Christians. I don't see when Black people are dying in the streets. I don't see all of these churches that we have, both Black and anyway, coming to the aid of our people, so where is Jesus? When Jesus walked into a church, he flipped over the table. Jesus didn't hang in the streets, he hung with the people.
Resistance for me is standing in my truth every day. It's showing up to work with people who look nothing like me and being myself. It's speaking out right now. It's walking around with a purpose and also thinking about something beyond myself. It's taking responsibility for community, essentially. I think, not to dovetail back to your last question, but I feel like part of resistance now for young people and millennials like myself is definitely the internet. I'm employed by the internet, so I certainly understand the power of it, and I think we just have to be careful with what we do online. I think the internet and social media has definitely given us a channel to mobilize our thoughts and give faces to the movement and mobilize ourselves in ways we can never imagine before, but it's crucial to marry that action with offline action. So a hashtag isn't enough. Like, we have dead bodies becoming hashtags, and we move on to the next trend the next day, the next week. So it's about thinking about what's the next phase of movement offline and mobilizing ourselves in real life, not just online.
I see all this stuff on my timeline, and, you know, especially when you're talking about Ferguson, it was like Twitter was reporting live from, and we were able to find out before any of these outlets could get anything out, get published, get it edited, make sure that it was copywritten, everything was spelled right. By the time they were done with that, we were already on the fifth video before they were hitting the first video.
That's right.
And it was empowering because everybody, people who were in Ferguson felt empowered because they're like, I can communicate with anybody so you guys can see what's happening to us. And that's really what took a really turn with news and social media, because for a long time, people still would use Twitter and Instagram to report. They'd say, well, it was on social media, but we're not going to use it. Just know that a lot of these people in these mainstream organizations are combing through these urban blogs to see what they can take. They say that it's not credible, but it's one of the first things that they look through to see what they can still make bigger content, which is why a lot of times you'll see something on a blog and then 5 days later it's on like USA Today and you're like, this is old to me.
As breaking news.
Right, as breaking news. Because when they before they publish, they Google it. And if nobody on their tier has reported, it's exclusive to them. Because they don't consider these blogs worthy enough to give the credit. You have to be really making sure that you're staying involved in the news in any way possible. Nothing is too small.
There are millions, hundreds of millions of people all around the world on social media, but it's really easy to actually get stuck in groupthink. And like I kind of touched on before, you get stuck in groupthink, you follow your own community, you kind of get in this like cyclical circle of such where you're not really doing anything in real life. It gives everyone access, but it's not just the good voices being heard, it's oversaturated with lots and lots of noise. So pushing through that noise is going to take a real life action.
To me, as a creative, I always consider myself a creative first. And so when I look at politics, it's very much the same thing, right? A lot of it is about taking a message that will translate to a large group of people to get them activated to come vote, right? But then it's also like being able to get up and speak. Like, we wouldn't know who Maxine Waters was maybe, well, we would know. But like, the nation may not know who Maxine Waters was if she didn't know how to get on TV and craft a message. To me, that is artistry. To be able to get up and say something that is gonna resonate with people, say it in a way that is going to make sense and translate, I think that is definitely art. And whether or not we like Donald Trump, what he's saying, what he's doing, whatever you want to call what he's doing in Washington, there's art to that. There's strategy to that. And I go back and forth every single day with debating whether or not I think he is a mastermind that knows every single thing that he's doing, or if he is an idiot who has really been lucky.
Sort of like us, yeah.
I mean, but like, there is art, there is strategy, there is...
And either way, it's effective.
And either way, I really think it's art, and I think it's important that we look at it as... Because the reason I think it's important that we see it as art is because it's intentional. Like, art doesn't happen by accident. Art is something that someone came up with, thought about, put together, and then offered to you.
Recognize that we're telegraphing our plans, right? Because I think we've bought into hype culture. And we think that hype culture is the only way to build momentum. And I really hope that we kind of graduate.
You don't see that Ku Klux Klan on YouTube. You don't see the LAPD when they're plotting on your children on Snapchat. Like, we gotta put these damn phones down. What if we come up with a solution today that means something? Well, they know that we're coming. So this is fine to bring the people together socially, but to get to really do real work, y'all, we gotta shut the phones down and we gotta get somewhere and close the door.